So I start a new chapter about number theory, the foundations for modern cryptography. First property that I'm going to visit is related to the property of modular arithmetic, namely if with Zn we denote the numbers from 0 to n minus 1, which form a commutative ring with being a group for addition, and a monoid, they have an identity but no inverse with respect to multiplication. There is a peculiarity of this group that of this set, namely with respect to addition, if we have A plus B equals A plus C, modulo modulo n, whether n is prime or not, then we can add on both sides with minus a, and we can infer that b congruent with c mod n. This is a nice property of inverses. What about the case when you have A times B congruent with A times C mod N? In this particular case, if N is not a prime, we are not guaranteed to have an inverse. Therefore, we may not be able to multiply with the inverse of N. There's this particular property, namely, if AB congruent to AC, therefore AB can be written as AC plus a multiple of N. There exists such an integer N, H, such that AB equals AC times plus HN, and we can rewrite this, moving AC on the other side, so we can write as A times B minus C congruent with H times N. Therefore, B minus C, here we are not talking about congruence, but about equality, so we can divide with A because we are in the realm of integers, so B minus C equals H divided by A times N. If A is relatively prime to N, so if greatest common divisor between A and N is 1, it means that since B minus C is an integer, H divided by A will be an integer, there's being no greatest common, no divisor between A and N. Therefore, this can be written as some product of K times N, where K is an integer. Okay, so what does it actually mean? Let's look at an example. For this, it basically states that there exist numbers for which, like 3 and 9, such that 2 times 3 congruent with 2 times 9. Modulo, let's say, 5, right? 12. So 2 times 3 is 6, 2 times 9 is 18, which is 12 plus 6. And we have this equality, and still we cannot divide by 2, which means 3 is different from 9 mod 12. Why is this the case? Because 2 and 12 are not relatively prime. But if the number a, that is common here too, is relatively prime to our modulus, like in the case of a modulus 5, then we have 2 times 1 equals 2, 2 times 2 equals 4, 2 times 3 equals 6, which is congruent with 1 mod 5, 2 times 4 equals 8, which is congruent with 3 mod 5. We see that the results are all distinct, and this is the case because 2 is relatively prime to 5 when we do this computation modulo 5. Now this is an important property, namely if we have a relation like a times b congruent to a times c mod a number n, we can divide by a, namely we are going to get unique b in this set of residues, so b congruent to c if greatest common divisor between a and n is 1. This is the first important property. Let's go to another property. This is formalized in Wilson's theorem. So one important property of prime numbers, if that square root of a number modulo prime has only two solutions. So let's assume we have the equation x squared equals 1 mod p, where p is a prime. Square root of 1 in this case will have exactly two solutions. And why is that the case? We can pass 1 in the other side, so we get x squared minus 1 congruent to 0, which is x minus 1 times x plus 1 congruent to 0 mod p, which means x minus 1 times x plus 1 is a multiple of p, or otherwise saying p divides x minus 1 times x plus 1. And if p is a prime number, then it must be either a divisor of x minus 1 or a divisor of x plus 1. So we have two cases. Case 1, p divides x minus 1, in which case we can infer that x minus 1 is a multiple of p, therefore x is a multiple of p plus 1, therefore x is congruent with 1 mod p. And the other case, case 2, we have p divides x plus 1, which means x plus 1 equals a multiple of p, therefore x is equal with a multiple of p minus 1, which means that x congruent with minus 1 mod p. So there exist only two possible solutions because you only have these two cases for the situation where p is a prime. If p is not a prime, then there may exist more than one, than two solutions for our equation x squared congruent with 1. But for now, we only care about the modulo a prime. Let's next see the place where we are using it, and this is Wilson's theorem. So what does Wilson's theorem says? It says that a number p is prime if and only if p minus 1 factorial congruent with minus 1 mod p. Let us see what is this property. So if p is, let's say, 3, let's check factorial of p minus 1. Factorial of p minus 1, minus 1 equals 2. Therefore, factorial of p minus 1 is 1 times 2, which is equal to 2, which, by the way, is congruent with minus 1 mod p. If p equals 5, p minus 1 is going to equal with 4. The factorial of p minus 1 is going to be equal 1 times 2 times 3 times 4, which is 6 times 4 is 24, which is congruent with 4 mod 5, which is same as minus 1 mod 5, right? What about the situation where the p is not a prime? So we have seen that for p primes we have this property that p minus 1 factorial is congruent with 1. Let's take p equals 4. 4 is not a prime. P minus 1 in this case will be equal to 3. Therefore, p minus 1 factorial is equal with 1 times 2 times 3, which is equal to 6, which mod 4 is different from minus 1, is not congruent with minus 1 mod 4. So what we can observe is that the property p minus 1 factorial congruent with minus 1 mod p is true if and only if p is prime. This is our conjecture, and Wilson's theorem is stating it. Let's see the proof. The proof is as follows. If we take all the numbers from 1 to p minus 1, 1, 2, 3, and so on, all the way to p minus 2, p minus 1, which is the same as 1, 1 has as inverse itself, and p minus 1 has its inverse itself. They are the only two square roots of unity we have seen from the previous property. There exists, based on the previous property, no other number between 2 and p minus 2 which is a square root of 1. Therefore, the inverse of each of them is another number in the same set from 2 to p minus 2. So for any j between 1 and p minus 1, the inverse of j is going to be different from j. It means we can partition the set in pairs where each number in this set is paired with exactly one other number whose inverse it is. If I is the inverse of J, then J is the inverse of I. So these pairs are disjoint. And in this particular case, we can regroup these pairs. So each pair is going to be separate, and the product of the numbers in each pair is equal to 1. Therefore, the product here from I equals to 2 to all the way to p minus 2 can be written as a product of pairs, each of those pairs be equal to 1. Therefore, it's going to be a set of pairs, each of them being equal to 1, the pairs of inverses. So the product of all these numbers over here will be equal to 1. And the product of the two remaining numbers is going to be 1 times minus 1. Therefore, the product of all the set of numbers from 1 to p minus 1 is going to be 1 times the numbers in between we have seen are equal to 1, and p minus 1 is going to be p minus 1. So the total product is p minus 1, which is congruent with minus 1 mod p. And this is the proof of Wilson's theorem on one direction. It proves that if p is prime, then the product of the numbers is minus 1. What if p is not prime? If p is not prime, then p can be written as a product of two elements, a times b. When you are going to write the numbers from 1 to p minus 2, if a is different from b, we have two cases, a smaller than b and a equals with b. For if a is different from b, then we have here somewhere a and b. When we are going to compute the factorial of p minus 1, this factorial will contain a and b, so therefore it's going to be a product of p with some other numbers, therefore will be congruent to 0 mod p. So it's different from minus 1, confirming Wilson's theorem. In case p is square of a prime, q prime, in this particular case p minus 1 factorial will be equal with 1 times 2 times our prime q times so on up to p minus 1. Therefore this is going to be equal with q times 1 times 2 times p minus 1 mod p. And in this particular case, the result cannot be equal to minus 1 because we have inverses for pairs of numbers that are relatively prime to p. The product of all these remaining numbers b equal to 1 as before, and the total result will be equal with q times 1 times p minus 1, which is going to be equal with p minus q, can be observed, it's equal to minus q, which is equal with p minus q, which will be different from minus 1 because q is different from 1. This was in the case q equals 1, then p would have been equal to 1, and that would have been a non-interesting case. Therefore, in this case also, Wilson's theorem is confirmed, and with this we conclude the proof of Wilson's theorem. And now we are ready to prove Fermat's theorem. Let's first understand what this theorem is stating. We are going to see it on a particular case. Let's work for a prime p equals 5. In this case, we are going to take a number a equals 2, and we are going to write the products between two times each other element of the set of residues mod 5. So 2 times 1 equals 2 mod 5. 2 times 2 equals 4. 2 times 3 will be congruent to 1. If 6 is congruent to 1, not 4. 2 times 4 is congruent with being equal to 8, which is 3 mod 5 again. Now, equality is the same as congruence. I'm going to multiply all these terms, all of them, one by one, under the congruence. So here we are going to give common factor 2, get 2 by 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus, we are multiplying, not adding them. So we are going to get 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, 4 times, times 1 times 2 times 3 times 4, which is 1 times 2 times 3 times 4, it's 4 factorial. On the other side, we are going to see 2 times 4 times 1 times 3, mod 5. This can be seen to be equal to 1 times 4 factorial. And on the other side of the equality, we see again the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, just in another order, so we can notice that they are also equal to 4 factorial, mod 5. From Wilson's theorem, since we are working mod a prime number, we know that 4 factorial equals minus 1, mod 5. Minus 1 is going to be relatively prime with any prime, therefore it has an inverse, and we can divide with its inverse, which is itself always. So we are going to get 2 to the power 5 congruent with power 4 congruent with 1 mod 5. And this is a particular instance of Fermat theorem for the numbers a equals 2 and the prime being equals to 5. So in this particular case, the exponent of 2 is 4, which happened to be like that because it's 1 less than the number of prime numbers. You notice that the total numbers of entries at the beginning was 4, from 1 to p minus 1 to 5 minus 1. Therefore, we are going to write this as a at power p minus 1 and this is congruent with 1 mod p. Okay, this is would be the generalization of the particular case that we have seen. Let's now prove the whole generalization itself. So we are going to start again with a number, a prime number p, and a number a is a property that a is relatively prime to p. A greatest common divisor between a and p equals 1. Generally means that we do not consider for now numbers like 0 or p itself. And we are going to follow the same pattern we have done before, writing a times 1 equals congruent with b1 mod p, a times 2 congruent with b2 mod p, and so on. A times any number I congruent to bi, a times any number j congruent to bj, up to the last case, a times p minus 1 congruent to b p minus 1. Okay, so everything here is mod p. Based on the first property we have seen before, if a times I congruent to a times g, And due to the fact that greatest common divisor between A and P was known to be, was assumed to be 1, we can infer that A is different from J. Is congruent to J, which basically says that all of the numbers B here are going to be distinct because all the numbers which you multiply here are distinct. Okay. Therefore, we can again multiply as before, and here we get p minus 1 a, so we get a at power p minus 1 times p minus 1 factorial, and in this case all the b's are permutations of each other, so it's going to be again p minus 1 factorial. We are going to see that from Wilson's theorem this is minus 1 minus 1, therefore a at p minus 1 is congruent to this 1, and we have proven Fermat theorem.